Right to Life Radio with John Girardi on Power Talk 96.7 and AM 1400, a production of Right to Life of Central California. And now, here's your host, John Girardi.
A Supreme Court case coming up to challenge Planned Parenthood versus Casey and Roe v. Wade? We might just have it. Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. Thank you all so much for tuning in. John Girardi here with you, Executive Director of Right to Life of Central California. I am joined today, as often, by the erstwhile co-host, Mr. Jonathan Keller.
That's me.
Good to be here with you, Jonathan.
Likewise. And that's a heck of an opening. I'm not even sure which case this is. Yeah. I'm very intrigued.
www.rtlcc.org if you want to learn more about what we do at Right to Life. If you want to learn more about our annual Christmas dinner and auction, rtlcc.org is the place to go. You can still get a ticket. You can still get a table. But do it quickly. Let us know. rtlcc.org. Okay.
In the words of Jesus to Judas Iscariot, whatever you are about to do, do quickly.
I mean, it's not that bleak, but yes. Yes, more or less. All right. We've got a great show for you today. Or at the very least, we have a show. Anyway, a happy Thanksgiving.
Talking will happen.
A happy Thanksgiving weekend to all.
Could you believe those Black Friday sales yesterday, John?
Boy, I was royally taking advantage of them. Definitely
crazy.
Those sales happened in the past.
And the Thanksgiving Day parade with that one point.
Yeah,
the
that
Macy's,
one part?
Uh-huh.
That was great.
Yeah.
Anyway, they had balloons. So, I was opening the show talking about something to overturn Roe v. Wade or Planned Parenthood versus Casey. And you may be wondering, what the heck is he talking about? All right. So there's been a little bit of pro-life news. Not much. We're kind of in the doldrums, kind of in the dog days of winter where the legislative sessions have all ended. The elections are all done. There's not much going on, but there is some news. This is a story from November 20th. Coincidentally. Attorneys general in 19 states asked the U.S. Supreme Court this month to uphold an Indiana law that protects unborn babies with Down syndrome and other disabilities from discrimination. The 2016 law prohibits discriminatory abortions based on the unborn baby's disability, gender, or race. Vice President Mike Pence, who was the governor of Indiana at the time, signed the law, but the abortion giant Planned Parenthood and the American Civil Liberties Union challenged it in court. So this touches on a really interesting topic, which is abortion and discrimination. We've talked in the past about some news stories from CBS News. I think this was about a year ago, right around now, which talked about how the nation of Iceland, they were very excited because in Iceland they had managed to eliminate Down syndrome. They've eliminated it. They've gotten rid of Down syndrome. And how have they done it? Wow, did they come up with some medical breakthrough? Is there public health policy in Iceland that's just kicking face and taking names? Have they done something incredible that no other country has done? No.
It all depends on the wording, John, because no babies are being born with Down syndrome.
Yes. Basically, all Iceland is doing is just diagnosing children with Down syndrome and then immediately aborting them. So basically, almost 100% of all children with Down syndrome are aborted in Ireland. They're not eliminating Down syndrome. They are eliminating people who have Down syndrome. And the topic of abortions based on some kind of discriminatory condition, an unjustly discriminatory condition, I should say, whether that be because of the baby's race, because of the baby's sex, sex-selective abortions are very much a problem, certainly in certain countries and in certain circumstances, or based on disability, this is a very real problem. And in 2016, then-governor of Indiana, Mike Pence, signed into law a bill that basically would ban those kinds of abortions specifically selected for the purpose in a way to discriminate against an unborn child because she is a female or because she has a disability, including developmental disabilities like Down syndrome.
Which, John, obviously you and I believe that all abortion is wrong, but there would seem to be some level of common ground that you could find with our friends on the other side of the political aisle often, realizing that if it is wrong to harass and target and harm vulnerable minority populations, whether they are mm-hmm. women or people with Down syndrome, it would seem especially wrong to do that in the womb.
And you would even think that maybe the 14th Amendment would have something to say about it. The 14th Amendment, which contains the Equal Protection Clause, guaranteeing equal protection under law. This part of the 14th Amendment was used ultimately to overturn segregation laws in various states, in Brown versus Board of Education. So it eliminated the concept of separate but equal. So what has happened to this law that Indiana passed? Well, unfortunately, the problem is that the Supreme Court has inserted itself into the ability of state lawmakers to regulate abortion in a really obtrusive way. Basically, they hamstring state lawmakers because, let's do a little bit of basic civics here. It's easy to pass a normal law. Let's go back to Schoolhouse Rock. You just need both houses of your state legislature to pass something, and then your governor has to sign it into law, and bada boom, you've got a state law. To pass a federal law, you just need both houses of Congress to pass something and the president to sign it into law. Bada boom, you have a law. The Constitution, though, is more important. It's more foundational to the structure of how the American government works. It protects some of the most important individual rights and liberties that we have as Americans. And as a result, it's really, really hard to change the Constitution. To change the Constitution, you have to amend the Constitution, which doesn't require just a majority of the House and the Senate and the president. To amend the Constitution, you need 2/3 of both houses of Congress, and you need like 3/4 of all the state legislatures. It's really, really hard to do. Now, so that's how you change the Constitution. But the problem is that the Constitution does not interpret itself. Okay. The First Amendment says that the right to freedom of speech shall not be infringed. But what is speech exactly? Is me publishing pornography, is that speech? Is me yelling fire in a crowded theater speech? Is me yelling at an angry mob, go get him, at a police officer, is that speech that is protected by the First Amendment? The answer to all three of those is no, by the way. No, and no. Those are expressive things. Those are using verbs and moving my lips and air sound waves emitting from my mouth and my lips forming them into words. But they are not speech that is protected by the First Amendment. And the Supreme Court winds up being the final arbiter looking at the history and tradition of the Constitution of what the actual text of the Constitution means as applied to day to day. The Supreme Court winds up being the final arbiter of what the law is. They interpret the law. That is their job. And ideally, they would do this in a way that is consistent with the actual text of what the Constitution says, with the original public understanding of what that text meant at the time it was written. Sometimes they don't, though. And sometimes the Supreme Court gets things wrong. But the problem is, basically, if the Supreme Court is the final arbiter of what the Constitution says, and all laws that you pass have to be consistent with the Constitution, or else they are struck down, basically all laws have to be consistent with what the Supreme Court says the Constitution means. Your laws have to be consistent with Supreme Court decisions. And so because the Supreme Court has said in Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey specifically that there is no permissible prohibition on abortion before the point of viability. And because the Supreme Court has said that, no, that's not just our opinion. That is embedded in the 14th Amendment. The 14th Amendment guarantees that you cannot put any substantial burden to a woman's ability to have an abortion before the baby is viable. Because the Supreme Court has done that, we can't just overturn what the Supreme Court says with a simple law. We can't contradict the Supreme Court with a simple law. We would need to actually amend the Constitution or wait for the Supreme Court to reverse itself. And that's basically what happened in this case. Indiana said, no, we're banning all abortions where you're only picking an abortion because to discriminate on the basis of sex, to discriminate on the basis of race, to discriminate on the basis of some kind of disability, including mental disabilities. And the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, which is the federal circuit court that includes a bunch of Midwestern states, Illinois, Indiana, etc., they heard this case and they struck this law down as unconstitutional because it violates the Supreme Court decision, Planned Parenthood versus Casey. And the Seventh Circuit is basically, according to basically the system of stare decisis that we have in this country, the Seventh Circuit has to follow the precedent given to it by the Supreme Court. They can't just reverse a Supreme Court decision.
You can only do that if you're the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals.
I mean, you can ignore what the Supreme Court says if you're the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, and then you immediately get reversed. And if you try to just ignore what the Supreme Court says, you immediately get reversed. And that's the problem. So the decision, so the Seventh Circuit upheld the decision to strike this law down in a decision from April of 2018. And it's actually two very interesting opinions. There was the controlling opinion. It was a 3-judge panel of the Seventh Circuit. The two judges in the majority ruled to overturn the law. And they were joined in a concurring decision by the one of the senior judges on the Seventh Circuit, Judge Mannion. And I want to talk about his decision because he clearly disagrees with the controlling precedent of Planned Parenthood versus Casey, thinks it's terrible, but he offers some real insight into why Planned Parenthood versus Casey is really bad. And I think he's sending some signals to the conservative majority on the U.S. Supreme Court to highlight all of the reasons why Planned Parenthood versus Casey is a bad precedent and should be struck down. And I'm really interested to see what a new Supreme Court with Brett Kavanaugh on it is going to do with this law. If they are able to hear this appeal, which the state of Indiana is trying to do, what will the Supreme Court do about this? All right, we'll be right back here on Right to Life Radio with John Girardi.
On the farm, it's kind of laid back, ain't much an old country bollock me can't hack.
John Denver.
Early to rise, early in the sack. I thank God I'm a country boy.
Right to Life Radio with John Girardi.
Kind of life never did me no harm, raising me a family.
This is Thank God I'm a Country Boy by John Denver. We're going to have some delightful country jams this week.
What's the occasion? I like the song, but...
It is in a group of old songs that we used in a prior episode of Right to Life Radio that I conveniently found and emailed to Raphael. So it's a lot of thought went into this. Lot of thought.
I feel like John Denver gets a little bit of a bad rap sometimes.
Well, he brought it on his own a bit because he had that one album where... It was like a really soft tone picture of him with no shirt on. And he's wearing like these glasses that are like, oh, I've heard them described before in a fashion that would probably be inappropriate for a family radio show.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, he kind of, you know, I don't know. The 70s were different and he kind of looked like someone maybe who would be driving a van with no windows that says free candy on the side. If you know what I mean.
Well, you were saying, you know, he brought it on himself, and I'm like, well, he did get on that plane, so.
Huh? Did he die?
Oh, yeah, he died in a plane crash.
John Denver did?
Yeah. This was like a long time ago.
You're thinking of Buddy Holly.
No. He died in a plane crash, too.
Really?
Yeah.
John Denver plane crash.
1997, October 13th.
Holy cow, I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah.
I thought he was still around.
Oh, no.
Jeez,
no.
I just thought
very
he'd
sad.
Very quiet. Oh, jeez.
he has been very quiet.
Well, he's been, yeah.
I'm sorry to break it to you, John, but jeez. John Denver is dead.
Gosh, I'm like experiencing this like in real time.
21 years ago.
Well, folks, you can see the devastation that the death of John Denver has wrought in my life right now in real time.
And now it's a John Denver tribute show, everybody.
Okay, well, rest in peace, John Denver, here on Right to Life Radio. Thank you all so much for tuning in. So we were talking about a Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals decision. Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals is one of those courts that's one click below the U.S. Supreme Court. And they heard a case regarding an abortion law that the state of Indiana passed. The state of Indiana passed a law banning abortions that are based in purely in the sex of the child, the race of the child, or whether the child has some kind of developmental disorder or disability. The Seventh Circuit had to, unfortunately, overturn that decision because both the liberal judges who heard it and the one conservative judge who heard it, both all three of them agreed that, unfortunately, the controlling Supreme Court precedent compels them to overturn the law, which stinks. So I want to read the concurring opinion by Judge Mannion. Judge Mannion has been a judge on the Seventh Circuit for a long time, Judge Daniel Mannion. And in addition to being a longtime judge on the Seventh Circuit, who was nominated there by President Reagan, is also a fellow graduate of a fine Midwestern university near the shores of Lake Michigan.
Indiana?
Well, actually, he did go to Indiana Law School, but chiefly his loyalties lie with a certain fine school of Catholic higher education dedicated to Our Lady, known as the University of Notre Dame. Wow. The 11-0 University of Notre Dame, Fighting Irish. Anyway, so Judge Mannion's a Notre Dame grad. He's
hopefully to be 12-0 by the end of today.
Hopefully by the end of today, 12-0. Go us, go Irish, beat Southern Cal. At any rate, so Judge Mannion is a very devout Catholic, very conservative, really good judge on the Seventh Circuit, and he was one of the three judges on the panel that heard this case. And I thought his concurring opinion, where he concurred in part and dissented in part, was really interesting, and I want to read some stuff from it. Okay, here's what Judge Mannion says. To put it mildly, this is an unfortunate case. What a great way to start. Yet I must agree with the court that Supreme Court precedent compels us to invalidate Indiana's attempt to protect unborn children from being aborted solely because of their race, sex, or disability. And even has a footnote that says, the term unborn child is disfavored by some pro-choice advocates, but it is also used in Supreme Court opinions. See Gonzales v. Carhart. I use it throughout this dissent to refer to the living fetus developing during the course of a pregnancy.
Wow.
Good for him. Judge Mannion. He's got a good law clerk who wrote that right there. Anyway. That a narrowly drawn statute. This is Judge Mannion talking again. That a narrowly drawn statute meant to protect especially vulnerable unborn children cannot survive scrutiny under Planned Parenthood versus Casey is regrettable. But the fact remains that under the Casey regime, the purported right to have a pre-viability abortion is more ironclad even than the rights enumerated in the Bill of Rights. Only a majority of the Supreme Court or a constitutional amendment can permit the states to place some limits on abortion. So
he's basically making an appeal. Hey,
he's saying, hey,
Justice Alito,
Supreme Court,
Justice Gorsuch.
And he's right. So one of the things he's highlighting is this problem in Planned Parenthood versus Casey, that basically in Planned Parenthood versus Casey, the controlling opinion in Planned Parenthood versus Casey set this standard for when states can ban abortion, when states can ban abortion. And it replaced the old structure from Roe v. Wade. The old structure from Roe v. Wade, it basically divided the pregnancy up into the three trimesters. In the first trimester, states can't do anything. In the second trimester, states can put in some health regulations that are for the sake of the mother's health. And in the third trimester, they can even ban abortion as long as they have a health exception. And the health exception makes any kind of ban on abortion meaningless because every single abortion involves a woman's health. Anyway. That got replaced in Planned Parenthood versus Casey. Planned Parenthood versus Casey, which was the Supreme Court decision in 1992, that basically, it's basically the successor of Roe v. Wade. It's really the controlling law on abortion in the United States today, much more so than Roe v. Wade. In Planned Parenthood versus Casey, basically the court divided it up into two stages. There's viability, there's pre-viability and post-viability. And viability is the term that refers to whether a baby could theoretically survive outside the womb. Now, the problem is that viability is a really stupid standard to use for determining whether an unborn child has value. Basically, all viability is a measurement of is, one, how good is your neonatal intensive care technology? And two, really, how well developed the baby's lungs are. That's really the chief thing that determines whether a baby is viable or not, is if the baby's lungs have developed enough, then they're probably able to survive. The baby's lungs have not developed enough, not able to survive. So basically the standard that the Supreme Court in Planned Parenthood versus Casey said was states cannot put any undue burden on a woman's right to access abortion prior to viability. Now, the problem is that what is an undue burden? Well, Judge Mannion talks about this a little bit. So he talks about, well, what is this right to abortion where you can't put an undue burden on someone? Here's what he writes. Judge Mannion writes, the ranking member of the Senate Judiciary Committee, Dianne Feinstein, has often referred to Roe as a, quote, super precedent.
So dumb.
Of course, there's no such thing. This is Mannion talking again. Of course, there's no such thing as a super precedent.
Wow.
Any case may be overruled by five Supreme Court justices. But ooh, while Roe isn't super precedent, it did spawn a body of jurisprudence that has made abortion the only true super right protected by the federal courts today. The purported right to an abortion before viability is the only one that may not be infringed, even for the very best reason. For an unenumerated right judicially created just 45 years ago, that is astounding.
Wow.
He goes on to talk about the doctrinal reason for this is that Casey's undue burden standard is not a means ends test, but a pure effects test. The key quote from the Casey joint opinion reveals this: a regulation of abortion is invalid if it has the purpose or effect of placing a substantial obstacle in the path of a woman seeking an abortion of a non-viable fetus. That means even a regulation narrowly tailored to serve a compelling state interest is invalid if it prohibits any abortions before viability. After all, a prohibition is not just a substantial obstacle, but a complete obstacle. As one commentator supportive of abortion rights explained, undue burden, holy... Then it starts getting into legal jargon.
But John, the good news is that that's exactly how we treat, like, the First Amendment. Correct.
No, I mean, religious that's liberty. The problem.
I mean, like, you can't infringe on people's religious liberty.
That's the thing. Like, there are different ways in which the government can intrude upon certain aspects of speech, on certain aspects of religious exercise. But the protection that's given to abortion, you can't ban abortion even for the best reasons. Like, hey, this person wants to abort this girl that he's going to have just because she's a girl, just because he hates girls. I mean, all of these reasons that otherwise would, you know, this woman wants to abort this child because his father was black. Like, even these horrible reasons to have an abortion, those unborn children are not protected from invidious, horrible discrimination that we would not protect in any other setting. But because of the stupid way in which the Supreme Court has entered itself into this discussion, we have to acknowledge this imaginary right that was, as Judge Mannion said, created by courts 45 years ago and has more protection than the First Amendment. All right, we'll be right back here on Right to Life Radio with John Girardi.
In my mind, I'm gone to Carolina.
Right to Life Radio here on Power Talk 96.7 and AM 1400. James Taylor with Carolina on My Mind.
Ain't it just like a friend of mine to hit me from
the best music in the greater Fresno area radio market. Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. Again, our Christmas dinner and auction, Friday, December 7th, a day that hopefully won't live in infamy. Hopefully it'll be a day that lives in fammy. In
that means
fammy.
More than famous.
Yes.
Infamous means he's more than famous.
Exactly, exactly. RTLCC.org if you want to go. You have the invitation right there. It'll show you all the ways to do it. Or during business hours on weekdays, you can call Right to Life of Central California, 229-2229, to get yourself a ticket. It should be a great time. It's our Pearl anniversary of the Right to Life Christmas auction.
Because
it's the 30th anniversary.
Wow, it's a 30th?
And as a result, we're raffling off. So in addition, we have all these silent auction items. We've got all these live auction items. And we've got a raffle of some banging pearl necklaces, pearl bracelet,
wow,
pearl earrings. And raffle tickets this year, $25 per raffle ticket.
Ooh.
Five for $100. So come on down, spend a bunch of money, get some pearls for your lady friend.
I like it.
Or for your wife. may they never
not,
meet.
Not both. That's right.
That was an old British Navy to our wives and our girlfriends. May they never meet.
That's right.
Anyway, Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. Thank you all so much. And again, RTLCC.org is the place to be. Okay. We're talking about Judge Daniel Mannion and his really ex. Now, you may be wondering, why are we talking about the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeal decision? This was the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals heard a case about an abortion law passed by Indiana. Indiana passed a law basically banning people from having abortions purely based on the child's sex, the child's race, or the fact that the child has a disability. And Governor Pence signed it into law. The law got struck down by federal courts. It got struck down by the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals. But the Attorney General of Indiana is now asking the Supreme Court to hear this case. So they've sent in a petition for writ of certiorari, which is basically the petition asking the Supreme Court, hey, we want you to hear this case. We want you to change your prior precedent as regards this case. Now, we were reading through the decision, and the court in the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals said, the controlling Supreme Court decision, Planned Parenthood versus Casey, compels us to strike this law down. And the concurring opinion was written by, this is really tangential. It's hard to do show prep, folks. The concurring opinion was written by Judge Daniel Mannion, who's a baller. He is a Notre Dame graduate. He's based out of South Bend, Indiana. And he wrote a decision saying, I disagree with the controlling Supreme Court precedent, but I'm obliged to follow it. And now let me give you all the reasons why the Supreme Court precedent stinks.
It was almost like he first had to say, all right, I'm going to tell you why. But first, the power of SCOTUS compels you. The power of SCOTUS.
Basically, the power of the Supreme Court compels you. Exactly. So one of the points he makes is that the right to have an abortion. He made a lot of fun of Dianne Feinstein, which I enjoyed. Dianne Feinstein, when Neil Gorsuch was having his confirmation hearings to be a Supreme Court justice, Dianne Feinstein kept asking him about the precedential value of Roe v. Wade, only she's not a lawyer and she's not very smart, so she didn't use language like, what's the precedential weight of Roe v. Wade? She asked him, do you agree that Roe v. Wade is a super precedent? And Gorsuch was like, it is precedent. It is controlling precedent. She's like, well, do you agree it's a super precedent? Which led a lot of commentators to ask, what the heck is a super precedent? That's not a thing. It's not a thing in law. I didn't cover that when I was in law school or, you know, taking the bar exam, because it's not a thing. There's no such thing as a super precedent. The Supreme Court has the ability to reverse its prior decisions as long as five justices agree. So there's no such thing as a super precedent. Some led some people to ask, well, is there a super duper precedent? Perhaps a super duper pooper scooper precedent. I think Roe v. Wade would definitely qualify for the pooper scooper treatment.
For the next Supreme Court justice, Dianne Feinstein is just going to go, oh yeah, I triple dog dare ya.
Is it a super duper pooper scooper Bradley Cooper precedent? That's the best kind. So Judge Mannion made fun of Dianne Feinstein in his opinion by saying, no, there's no such thing as a super precedent. But unfortunately, the way that abortion is treated by the federal courts is as if it's a super precedent, because it actually has more protection on it than most of the actual rights that are actually written out and protected in the Constitution and in the Bill of Rights. So one of the things Judge Mannion writes is this, that today's outcome is compelled. Begs for the Supreme Court to reconsider Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey. But assuming the court is not prepared to overrule those cases, it is at least time to downgrade abortion to the same status as actual constitutional rights. This is great. The court can start by permitting the states to assert their legitimate interests in defense of abortion laws. Since Casey disavowed universal application of strict scrutiny in abortion cases, the question remains how to determine the proper means ends test to apply. So let me explain what this means.
Okay.
Generally, if you are a state lawmaker and you're passing a law that might be infringing on some claimed right by someone, there are certain tests you have to satisfy, right? Let's say, and some of these tests... Let me talk about two of them. There's the strict scrutiny test, and there's the rational basis test. Okay. There's certain things that the Supreme Court, in its constitutional law jurisprudence, has said any infringement on this is judged on the basis of strict scrutiny. Okay. So let's say you pass a law saying welfare is only eligible to white people. It's pretty controversial.
Yep.
Immediately very controversial. Okay. Basically, this law would get appealed and the Supreme Court would judge it on the basis of what's called strict scrutiny. Basically, you would need to say, okay, well, you are now discriminating on the basis of race. In order to do that, you must satisfy the strict scrutiny standard that you have to have an incredibly compelling government interest, and you have to accomplish that government interest in the most narrowly tailored way possible to infringe on people's rights in the narrowest way you possibly can. So effectively, there's almost nothing that satisfies strict scrutiny. Strict scrutiny is effectively if you have, you're never allowed to do something, almost never allowed to do something that merits strict scrutiny. It's a really stringent standard. So that law banning welfare to black people would be struck down on the basis of strict scrutiny. Now, so that's like the strongest protection for a constitutional right that the Supreme Court can give. Now, a very lax protection is what's called rational basis scrutiny, where basically the government just has to show you have an interest that is and that your means for attaining that interest are rationally related in some way. You don't have to show much. If the government is able to regulate something on rational basis test scrutiny, they're almost always able to regulate that thing. Now, here's the problem. The kinds of things that you can that you can only regulate on the basis of strict scrutiny, like racially based government laws that favor one race over another, laws that discriminate against people on the basis of race, laws that discriminate against people on all these protected categories. You have to show a really compelling interest before you can start doing those things. When it comes to abortion, though, even for things that in any other universe, you need to show a really compelling reason. You can say, hey, here are people aborting children just because they're girls. Here are people aborting children just because they're disabled. These are all categories that merit a lot of protection. Maybe not as much as race, but it merit a lot of protection. And yet it doesn't matter how good of a reason you have. The Supreme Court says, nope, your right to have an abortion is ironclad. There's absolutely no circumstance you could give where we would allow you to, we would allow the state to prevent you from having an abortion. So genuinely, when he's saying that abortion is a super right, he's right. Your right to have an abortion is more protected than your right as an African American not to be discriminated against, because the government could potentially, theoretically, has the ability at least to give a really compelling reason to discriminate against you. In the case of abortion, they can't even present a really compelling reason. You're literally, your right to abortion is literally more protected than your right not to be racially discriminated against. It's unbelievable. And I echo Judge Mannion in calling on the Supreme Court to reconsider Roe in the case. All right, we've gone way too long in this segment. We're going to catch up in the next segment. Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. We'll be right back here on Power Talk 96.7 and AM 1400. Ladies and gentlemen, Right to Life Radio with John Girardi, and this is Miss Tammy Wynette.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman.
See, this the video for this, Tammy Wynette's got hair like,
your love,
her hairdo is like 2 feet tall, and it is not moving like 1 millimeter. It's like so much hairspray holding that thing up. Gosh, she's got some pipes. Anyway, Right to Life Radio.
Famously thrown under the bus by Hillary Clinton during their interview.
Really?
Oh, yeah. When
she interviewed Hillary Clinton?
No. When Hillary Clinton was being interviewed about her husband's indiscretions, she famously said in her very put on Southern accent, which appeared to disappear as soon as she was the senator from New York. Listen, I'm not going to be like some little Tammy Wynette stand by your man. I've got my own blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
But she basically...
she did stand by her.
She did. Through Monica, despite her loud protestations.
That she would. She 100% did. Which, you know, hey, good for Hillary Clinton. You know, marriage is a good thing.
Yeah.
Marriage is a good thing. Anyway.
Yes.
Right to
I should clarify in case my wife is listening to this. Me saying I was making that not in reference to my own marriage, specifically in reference to the Clintons' marriage.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think Julia knows you well enough to realize that that's what you were going about.
In case anybody listening thinks that I do not have a wonderful wife and a very happy marriage, I just want to clarify that. So,
okay, sounds good.
Yes,
marriage is good.
Yes,
marriage is what brings us together today. Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. It's not what's bringing us together today. We are not, no.
No.
Not an Adam and Steve situation here.
No.
It's Life Radio.
No.
All right. Well, we've been talking about what the Supreme Court could do with abortion, and there's actually a case that is making its way up the federal courts. Actually, I think there are a couple of cases. And maybe what I'll try to do over the next several weeks of Right to Life Radio, by the way, happy Thanksgiving to you all. What I'm going to try to do over the next several weeks of Right to Life Radio is look at some of these abortion cases that are making their way through the federal court systems and try to discuss them as what they could do, what they mean as potential vehicles for overturning Roe versus Wade. Because, you know, now that there's a new person in Justice Kennedy's seat, people are going to start testing this. People are going to start testing exactly what the Supreme Court is going to do with Roe v. Wade now that all of the original people who signed on to Planned Parenthood versus Casey are no longer on the court, including the three key essential people who wrote the controlling opinion in Planned Parenthood versus Casey, which was only a plurality opinion, by the way. It was not a majority opinion. It was just enough people concurred with the plurality opinion that that's what happened. Sandra Day O'Connor is gone. David Souter is gone. And Anthony Kennedy is gone. And there's nobody on the court who likes the Planned Parenthood versus Casey precedent. None of the conservatives like it. None of the liberals even like it. I think they agree with many of the outcomes of Planned Parenthood versus Casey, namely the fact that abortion is for the most part protected. But they dislike the fact that Planned Parenthood versus Casey allows some regulation around the edges of abortion. One of the things Judge Mannion talks about, he mentioned in this case, and again, the case we're discussing is a case coming out of Indiana, where the state of Indiana passed a law to prohibit abortions that are purely based in a racist decision. I don't want a baby whose father's black and I don't want to have this baby. A sexist decision. This baby's a girl. I don't want to have a girl. I'm going to abort the baby. Or on a basis discriminating against someone because they have a disability. This baby has Down syndrome. I don't want to bring this baby into this world. This baby has spina bifida, et cetera. So Indiana passed a law banning abortions for those kinds of discriminatory reasons. And it was immediately struck down because the controlling Supreme Court precedent basically says, no, you can't ban abortion at all during before viability. You just simply can't. You can't put any kind of substantial burden on a woman's right to choose. And that term substantial burden is basically ironclad. The only kinds of regulations you can put on, as Judge Mannion from the Seventh Circuit, Notre Dame grad, awesome guy, Reagan appointee. The only kinds of restrictions that you can put on abortion are restrictions that provide more information. So a 24-hour waiting period, informed consent provisions, or things like parental notification. And so the question is, you know, what is Brett Kavanaugh going to do? What is Brett Kavanaugh going to do on the question of abortion? How is this new Supreme Court going to shape up? Reading this decision, and Judge Mannion is not, Judge Mannion is hardly a radical. Judge Mannion from the Seventh Circuit wrote a concurring piece in this Seventh Circuit decision striking down Indiana's law banning discriminatory abortions. And he talked about all the ways in which Planned Parenthood versus Casey stinks. He says, you know, there's all kinds of other ways to regulate abortion other than the way in which we regulate it now, where basically there's abortion is protected more than any right in the Bill of Rights. So I think that the absurd conclusions that you get from Planned Parenthood versus Casey are such that I believe Brett Kavanaugh will really strongly consider revisiting Roe v. Wade if the Supreme Court decides to take this case.
It's almost like we should be thanking Dianne Feinstein for lobbing up that super precedent talking point.
Yeah, because it's, I mean, she's, That's the thing. Like, the way in which abortion has been treated in the courts, in public opinion, people don't realize how ridiculous it is. People don't realize that, yes, actually the right to have abortion, to have an abortion, is actually better protected than even the right to freedom of speech, because there are ways in which you can restrict someone's freedom of speech. If you have a compelling government interest and you narrowly tailor your regulation of speech in the most narrow way humanly possible to achieve that really compelling interest, you can regulate someone's free speech. But you can't do that for abortion, because the Supreme Court has created this new standard. Or it was new in 1992, I guess. We've been living under it for 20 years, but new in the context of a country that is, you know, over 200 years old, and a constitution that's over 200 years old. This new standard that basically says, nope, there's no possibility to infringe upon a woman's ability to get an abortion before the child is viable, even if you're trying to restrict her ability to have an abortion for the best reasons, to outlaw, to try to protect unborn children on the basis of race, on the basis of sex, whatever. There's no way in which you can protect unborn children. So I really hope this decision from the Seventh Circuit makes it to the U.S. Supreme Court. And I hope that it gets overturned.
John, that would almost be too good to be true.
My gosh, Jonathan Keller. You genius. Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. That's the old Italian music. That's a sign. It means it's time to go. Thank you all so much for listening. It's been an absolute delight. Again, rtlcc.org if you want to learn more. Check out our Christmas dinner and auction Friday, December 7th. Or make us a nice, hefty little end-of-year donation. Thank you all so much. We'll see you later. God bless. Right to Life Radio with John Girardi. Can't take my eyes off you. Part of the way that I stand. There's nothing else.